Kemcho, how is everybody? Welcome to the show. Today is Thursday evening, 6 p.m., which means it's time to rock and roll on a show called Cock and Bull. I am, of course, the bull, the rest are cocks. And in a manner of speaking, it's a rooster, it's a female bird that some people use for food and some people keep as pets. Anyway, leaving that aside, quick quick thing that's happened. Another thing I've mastered, folks, you'll be very happy to know, I have mastered brushing my teeth with my left hand. Left hand. I've always been a righty. I don't know about you guys, but I can now brush with my left hand, which gives me right hand freedom to do anything else while I'm brushing my teeth. It's a bathroom, so, you know, use your imagination and take your time. Whatever things
are. Shaving
that
is very risky.
Shaving is risky. Yes, yes. Especially there. Especially where you're thinking, Akash. Especially.
I think
there.
You should, Sayas, you should also learn what is a toothbrush, because what you in your hand was a paintbrush.
My wife, I'll hold it up so people can see. My wife is an artist. And so we have all kinds of brushes lying around. After some time, when you have such a plethora of brushes, you don't give a damn. You use whatever brush for whatever. So anything which I know is a little dirty and they won't retouch, I use that. Because the rest of the family is hygienic. Let me just get that off the board immediately. It's only me who's a little easygoing with whatever appliance goes inside my mouth. But there are bigger rascals out there, as we're going to talk about on this show. There are people out there who have done much bigger crimes than me, or yes, at least have images that are now being shattered slowly, left, right, and center. This reminds me of Tiger Woods. Before we get into the story of Bill Gates, Tiger Woods was the most perfect sportsman in the history of the world. He was just too good to be true, and then everything came out, you know. Fighting with the wife, accidents, drugs, drinks, pornography and pornographic girlfriends. Oh, not pornographic girlfriends. Girlfriends in from, help me. People who work in pornography.
He slept with several women.
Yes, that's good. That's research at its best. That's why Cock and Bull is here,
you know,
to stay.
There was this comedian, Jared Carmichael, who said ki, Tiger Woods was so successful that he got paid for his affair, you know, literally. Like, uski biwi ne gaadi tod diya to usko naya gaadi de diya types. So, abhi,
you know how much it cost him, that divorce? He no longer was the richest sportsman in the world. You got to be very careful to become super successful. Which brings us superbly segued to William Gates.
Yes. Yep. So, it's been multiple instances have been coming out of Bill Gates either cheating or always attempting to cheat. So basically, he's like a serial cheater, yeah, attempter. So basically, what is being said is that he would often show up to work in his Mercedes and then get into his Porsche, his more fancy Porsche, and go to meet his mistresses
in
that
car.
Porsche. Yeah. So basically, he's going to meet these women, and then he would show up back at work, get back into his Mercedes, and then go back home after that. So this used to be like his way of getting away with it, or supposedly.
Great modus operandi, because, you know, you come to work, you put on that whole image of whatever, and you go back home in that same image, and in between you're somebody else. I super piece of acting. He could be an Indian politician, the way he can just switch like that, left, right.
Actually, Suresh, he could be any Indian girl of our age. Because all of them used to do this, if you remember.
That's
we would
true.
Go home and
clothes.
Pick them up, salwar kameez,
change the
in
clothes,
the back
yeah.
of the car,
oh!
change.
Boob and tube and all that.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's
my
a story
house,
I want
my
to hear.
My house,
great parallel.
No, Akash, I was the dresswala. They would come to my house to change. I had a very liberal parents and, you know, lots of rooms. My sister left early. So they would come. They'd just land up and change their clothes. And then exactly what he said. They'd come in salwar kameez with the bindi and everything. And they come out ravishing like models with boob tube and stomach showing. I was like, my own mother was like, where did the other girls come from? I said, no, mom, they're the same girl. He just gone to the washing machine drying process. What hair... That's a lovely. I wish we had visuals to show people how the women would metamorphosize once they went inside and went almost from ethnic to Western and Western towards the how do you say slutty without meaning it so it doesn't sound sexist? I know I don't mean it like
it's
that, but you know it would be. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Come on, guys, help me out here. This political correctness can't look at the tweets that are happening in England and all that. We got to. I mean, punishment.
I'm trying
crime.
To think of the right word. Which
sexy.
Sexy. There you go.
Erotic?
That would not have gotten you shot at it.
Yeah, but you didn't come back in time, did you? You let me go down with the ship and then you want to throw the rope. The guy's already in the sea. What's the point? He's dead now. Yeah. And of course, you choose the one day when the wife is in the background. And the one thing she won't tolerate is sexism. We'll get away with everything else. Yeah. Damn you guys. None of you have any bairi sitting behind.
No, I only have...
He's got a wall. If she's there, she's behind the wall.
Funny how the wall sometimes comes into Akash's specs as well.
Yeah, yeah, because it, I don't know why, but this software has this really bright white background on the image. So it's like, I don't know. Are you guys not
getting it? Point, it reflects from behind.
So much better. Is this better?
Yeah, it is actually. Yeah. It went away.
Yeah, it's reflecting me off the thing.
Akash is showing off.
That. Okay, yeah. That makes
like
sense.
This is the
Akash. I think it's a, like a bit of showing off, you know, frankly, because we have 3-bedroom hall. He has a light. 3-bedroom wall. Hey, I've got a light, and I would show it to you, but then the whole thing will get destroyed, and Maya's gone off somewhere. The lights come. I didn't tell you. For those watching the show, Amit kindly sent a light. No, I want to get you off the hook for everything.
Thank
you. Send the light, Amazon or somebody, Flipkart, somebody send the. Why give them a plug? If the show gets 1 million plus views, why give Amazon a plug? Yeah. What the hell? Why not?
Amazon will appreciate it, man. Pay it
they
forward.
Will,
no? Yeah, they will
pay it forward. Yeah, yes. Okay, so we've already done the advertising. Now just send the money. I get it. That's how much you're thinking. Gujarati Manas, sir. Gujarati Manas. This is the way to think. This is marketing at its best. Most skillful. So the light, let me just say, this is like we have to say this to the audience. The sound and the light has been fixed from Amit's side. He has sent the light via Amazon. And the sound is also fixed. This is his thing that I'm wearing and everything. So now it all depends. The Wi-Fi is in my hand. So in a sense.
No, it looks like the Wi-Fi is working good, finally, after quite a while.
Well, the wife had a few words with the Ambani family, and after that, everything seems to be better. I don't know whether she said that she's going to come over or she'll send me, but either way, it's working now.
Yeah. Either way. Yeah. I think we should just be happy. But, so the thing about Bill Gates, we were talking about that, right? I mean, like...
Naughty boy Bill.
So here's the thing, right? Antrik, she was saying that it's disputed as well. I'll tell you why this is so surprising, right? Because we never heard anything like this. And Cyrus, there were like, so I don't know if you remember this site. There was a site called ValleyWag. It came out at the same time as Gawker and all of that. The people who ran that site hated Microsoft. If Bill Gates was this kind of like, you know, serial womanizer out and about in town in Seattle, like week in, day in, day out, this stuff would have come out, I feel like, or at least the rumors would have been there. And this is like just
what they're saying.
Yes, thank you.
What they're saying is this was an open secret. They're saying this was an open secret.
But I mean, like
the article that I've read.
So have,
when you say open secret for the fraternity, open secret for the wife, because that's two different things.
I think inside Microsoft, this is an open secret, is what my understanding
from
reading
these articles. They will mostly keep it. I can't believe it. You tell your
also all these people have to sign NDAs. They had to apparently sign NDAs if they were in the company. They had to sign NDAs to not be able to talk about Bill Gates' managerial skills and the way he manages his managing style.
Yeah,
which includes everything.
No, because he's an asshole to work for, right? I mean, like that. See, again, that has come out over and over again, right? You've heard many times that he's a horrendous person.
You've made Antariksh also sign this thing, non-disclosure.
Antariksh does not have a non-disclosure. Antariksh has
underwear.
That's up to him.
Not committed.
That's up to him. I don't know. Antariksh, I think I don't remember what's in the contract, but I think he might have a non-compete, in the sense that he's not supposed to do I think he's not supposed to do podcasts as well, and he has to do confidentiality for company signed NDAs.
Yeah, I find it really evil, you know, when people do that, because basically everyone has one niche, and that's the way they don't want you to work. So if you're a singer, they say you can't sing. If you're a doctor, you can't practice medicine. That's the meanest thing.
As Amit's temporary law, not I would say lawyer, but
almost lawyer.
Say lawyer.
He can. 1 year LLB.
Graduate. But no, but
full graduate.
Yeah, the argument would be that Antariksh has gained a lot from IBM in terms of networking, skill set, expert guidance, etc., etc. People who are oldest in the game.
Right.
So then,
no, but so there's also...
His contact list is Naveen, me and you, Akash. So mom and dad are not impressed. Huh? He has started with Johnny Lever and Kapil Sharma, and then he take him to America and meet the big Bill Burr and gang. All, as we say in Gujarati, balls.
So what I'd say, right, Akash, is that it's not about what he gains out of this, right? He should gain out of it. That's the point of him working for a company like this, right? That you gain these kinds of things. But what happens is that he's an employee at this point in time, right? He is not always going to be an employee, right? So there are people who are not employees who have no non-competes, right? They can do whatever they want to. But if you take the full-time job at a company like ours, right? And this is not just us, right? It's ESPN
or in most places,
if you are taking a full-time job, then you have to be exclusive to the network in the sense that I don't want to see Antriksha, I don't know how much you how okay you are with me talking about this, and stop me if you want me to, right?
No, please be as open, and if you want to dismiss him from the job also, this is the right forum.
No, this is not the right. There was a period in time which at the end of last year where Antriksha was thinking of leaving fairly seriously. And I was okay with that. And I was very, I tried to do my best, say, hey, please do whatever help we can do, et cetera, right? Then we had another conversation. He decided to stay, right? But at that point in time, the one discussion that I had with him about what are the conditions for staying, right, was that Antriksh will be somebody who's fairly prominent on the IVM network in the sense that you'll see his face all the time, you'll be talking all the time. And I don't want him to be doing another show for somebody else. I don't want him to be doing another.
So it's not a non-compete. A non-compete is when he can't work anywhere after he quits.
Those are not enforceable, no. And those are ridiculous bullshit, man. Honestly, they're not enforceable. It's restraint of commerce.
What is enforceable? But
it, just from a logical perspective, now Akash, it's restraint of commerce. How can you stop somebody from working?
Yeah. Restraint of trade is fundamental. It's above everything else. That's my biggest issue. But coming back to Silvery, I just think that Silvery, you've made the right choice in staying back because now, you know, I'm sure your BMW 7 Series is just a month away and your life is, I mean, the phone calls don't stop and the gigs that you've got lined up post lockdown. From what I hear, you're going to Barbados and you're joining Naveen in Philippines. Yep. I want to know more about that one day. What the hell is that Philippines show and why did he not turn up in the end? But coming back to salacious gossip, it's like, you know, dog's potty. You have to find it. You can't not find it. So yeah. I find that part is a little odd that salacious gossip didn't get out in a gossipy world that we live in, you know, because it doesn't have to come to the NDA. Your mother, cousin, sister, come on, look at the way we're talking. You know, slack people off left, right, and center without even meaning to, without malice sometimes. And it goes to, you sit at the dinner table, it goes to them and from them to some other group from them. So just think about it. There's no way such a high profile guy, if he was monkeying around, it should have got out. I find that is difficult. Mm-hmm. I can't get that.
Well, I don't know, man. All things are possible. Anything is possible. I mean, like, you know, the world has showed us that, things that you would not expect can happen, right? But at the same time, I feel like there were always kind of, like, Harvey Weinstein, there were always rumors around that guy, weren't there? I mean, like, you know, when you're talking about, when you're talking about this degree of compulsive this, I feel like there are rumors and then it comes out, right?
This modus operandi thing, Amit,
Bill Gates is too smart. He's the kind of person who's so smart. I would assume he's like a socio psychopath or whatever. And genius narcissist person.
Because look at the MO. The MO is a little sleazy also, right? But it's also super smart sleazy. I mean, the fact that you change the car, so you know, another avatar leaves, another avatar comes, then the old guy goes back, the family man with the briefcase. Hi, doggy. How are you? Hi, honey. I'm home. All that shit. I mean, we carry that. I mean, that's in a way a lot of respect. You know, it's legendary.
Hey guys, we got a Facebook comment.
Oh God.
I've not seen a Facebook comment till now ever.
It's Zuckerberg. He wants help.
Deepu Sabu sent us a Facebook comment. No, it's cool. I mean, like, we've been live on Facebook for a long time, but we only get YouTube comments. Now I'm seeing a Facebook comment for the first time. Made me excited. I'm sorry. It has very little to do with our conversation, but I just got excited.
Yeah, also the question is so unrelated to anything we're talking about right now, but hey, you want to do that? We should all be on some sort of narcotic substance. So it explains why we have disassociated conversations and we can just have fun. This is what I do when I was drunk. Akash, you should have met me when I was drunk. We would have so much fun. Two lines would go into another point altogether.
I met Cyrus when he was drunk. It was interesting. When? I met you, I met you hammered out of your brains. You remember, what was that thing with the rooftop bar at Colaba? Vishal Magnani's.
Yeah. Aisha, where did we get married? That engagement?
You got married there?
We had one engagement there. That Vishal Magnani's place, yeah. It was the actual marriage. I was there. One thing. It was the actual marriage. I'm googling. Aisha, what is the name of the place in Colaba? She doesn't remember the place either.
I can't remember. It's like a hotel. It was on like the 8th or 9th
floor. Yeah. What's the name of the hotel, Aisha? But tell us the name of the hotel. We're live. People are now going to. They don't want the conversation to go on until we give them the name of the hotel.
Is this near Radio Club?
It is near Radio Club.
Isn't that
Harbour?
No.
Not Harbour View.
It's where the.
I know what kind of girls you've gone to Harbour View with, Palki Rishi. Used to be. I hope if your family is listening, you've been exposed. You've been exposed on the show. Well, let's Cloud see NDA.
It was called. It was called Cloud Nine.
Club Nine. Club Nine. Aisha.
It was called Cloud Nine.
Cloud Nine. Cloud Nine.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes. I met you over there once, it was interesting.
This is before we worked together, but
this is before we worked together. This is like that place has been shut for a while too, right? So this was like way back when. This was before you were married too.
Yeah, Palki was.
Palki was at, what was that guy's name? Kishan something, no?
No. That's. Palki Kishan, yeah.
Kishan something.
Socialite guy. I used to change socialite guy, yeah. In the car and go to the next party.
Sorry, the other two
have lost interest in our conversation. Bill Gates' sex.
Are we going to take the clubhouse question?
I think we should.
We can take the clubhouse question.
It came on the screen and all.
Yeah, we'll do that.
We can take the clubhouse question.
We were just showing off our new interface, Akash.
Oh, okay.
Also, the drunken story has no story. Leave it.
No, there was no story there. It was interesting to see you. So this is before you were married. You were there running after somebody. You were there because somebody else was there. I don't understand who it was.
I have a poster of Bill Gates. Maru Pachal. John, huh? Dikra? John.
This was well before you were married. This was, I think, 97 or 98 or something like that. Well before you were married.
We're dating from 94.
Oh, okay. <All right. laughs> So maybe I misinterpreted.
What a stupid idea a podcast is, really. No a podcast. Okay. Yeah.
Should we go
to Clubhouse?
I tried to make it nice and easy for everybody.
It's a good segue. It's a neutral area. Can you go straight there?
Let's talk about Clubhouse.
Yeah, please explain.
Like, we should.
I have a lot of calls saying do Clubhouse.
So Clubhouse is a new social media app which has just come to India. It is, I think it's been going around, become really popular in the US in the latter half of 2020. And it just came to India. It's become really popular. It's basically an audio-only social media platform. Like how Instagram is a pictures and videos platform. Clubhouse is a purely audio platform. You cannot post anything else. You cannot message anyone else. You have to just talk to them in a room on audio. So it's kind of like a room.
For ugly people, basically.
For podcasts. Okay, sure.
It's a voice chat room. Basically, it's a chat room. It's not, I would say, it's somewhat different than a social media network.
You're going back in time.
You are, because it's not asynchronous, right? Whereas most social media is asynchronous, where it doesn't matter when you consume it. Whereas Clubhouse has to be consumed at the time it's being created. So it's a chat room. It's live.
That's why the word club is literally the club meets and chats.
Correct.
I like it.
Yeah.
But how do you? Go on.
I think in practice, it does not work out. It's not like a free flow of ideas. It's fucking idiots talking about stuff. Like, it's
idiotic
no
things.
Offense.
Just creepy people want to meet.
I mean, I just feel like while I agree that everybody has something to offer in terms of knowledge to me, but at the same time, like,
you bastard.
Fuck off, yaar. I don't want to listen to six dudes talking at 11:30 about whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
I think it comes down to what I've understood is Clubhouse. It all comes down to who you follow and what kind of rooms you're a part of, obviously, right? So basically, the more kind of interesting people or the people that you would be interested in listening to, the more kind of those kind of people you follow, the more your wall will get populated with those kind of rooms. And then you'll be able to go to those kind of rooms. The more you use it, basically.
I need to unfollow a lot of people.
Is it subject matter or the person?
There's no other word for it. That's the exact thing that they're doing.
Because it's like an extension of Facebook. Exactly what Akash is saying.
It's intellectual masturbation, man.
No, it's not even intellectual. It's just the fact. It's like WhatsApp and Facebook creates these monsters where people have ideas. People you grew up with who never speak, and suddenly they have ideas. People have no comments in their life. Suddenly they have ideas and thoughts and philosophies. And I know and I think and I should. And suddenly you're like, what happened to Mehul? He was just a normal guy, never spoke. I can't remember him for 20 years. And now he's telling you about left-wing versus right-wing politics and this and that. I'm like, oh, too much. It's very scary. I think we should ask a guest before you use the internet. Should have like a they should have like a rating. What do you say, Amit? It's like democracy. You can't just give it. You can't use the internet until you have a certain Because so people just thoko, it's just thokaing left, right. It's exactly what Akash is saying.
It's interesting. It just, there was a real proposal out in the US at some point in time. Should there be a driver's license for the internet equivalent?
Yes, yeah, something like that.
Should you, Cyrus, you would not get one.
I'm okay. I don't care enough about it. Amit, I hate indulging in this WhatsApp chat and all. It is a crap out of me because there's too much formality and pretend sincerity and it drives me nuts. And I try my best not to get involved in that. But after 5 minutes, we've discussed it to death, yaar.
Yeah.
And Facebook is what? Facebook is like the philosopher side of the same person now. And oh, God, man, come on, yeah. Stay but safe, everybody. India needs us. Ooh, fuck you. I hear stay safe again. I'll kill you myself.
I agree. Can I just say this? I've been off social media more or less completely, except for Twitter. Like, I've been off Instagram. I've been off Facebook.
You chased a girl at Cloud9, you should be.
Okay. All right. Hey, listen, dude. I can chase girls wherever the fuck I want. Right? That's not really...
I was on a break.
There you go.
After 9 vodkas.
Please don't chase women, Amit. It's not appropriate anymore.
I don't chase women. I'm saying that if I wore a leopard skin
kapda,
he has to Uber the women back.
Amit, do you shoot your shirt on Clubhouse? That's something.
Do I shoot my shirt? What does shooting your shirt mean?
Shooting your shirt is like a dating thing or whatever, where people.
It's a Tinder
of
Clubhouse,
up.
Is it?
Clearly, the answer is no, right?
Never say that because I'm told all kinds of people are on all these dating apps and all. You know, that's another world we have to expose. Unbelievable. Taking on different avatars and going on to these apps.
I'm
told all my friends are on it and they pretend not to be. Okay, it's scary.
If you look at a dating app, these guys are young. I'm a little older. So the women who are on this are almost all older women, right? So it's mostly women in their 30s or 40s.
Put it that way, it sounds pathetic. You know, it's almost like you're standing outside this geriatric ward and, you know, like...
I don't have the patience for a 22-year-old girlfriend, right? I mean, like, it has to be...
Ageism! Ageism, my brother! Ageism!
100% ageism. But the thing is that what you see is like the number one comment, right, from any of these women is that, no married men, please. Now that if you see it from every single one has it, that means that there's clearly a problem there, right?
It's only them.
Very interestingly, Tinder just launched a new feature like 3-4 days back about no contacts. Basically, your contacts will not show up. So there is no way. That's like this. Apparently, this feature is being meant. They're saying it's meant for cheating. Exactly. Your wife can never show off or somebody you know.
Because obviously Tinder is designed by people like us who are thinking in that way only. This wrong way.
Yeah.
But a lot of apps are designed that way. I think, this is going to sound slightly radical, but perhaps this could be a solution in this scenario. Mm-hmm. People are unhappy in marriages. That's why they cheat. Okay.
Yeah.
I think that you shouldn't curtail the men from cheating. I think you should encourage the women to cheat. As well.
if you are in an unhappy marriage, because
Mard log ko aisa confidence hai ki bench mein ko jo karna hai main karega. Women should also be able to do that. That way at least ghar pe jhagde kam honge. I don't know. You know?
Main nahi. Remember, there's a change. You come in your one car and you leave in another car and then you come back into the old car. That's the whole thing. Tinder is the same. You metamorphosize into something else.
It's that or divorce law reform. Okay, so I feel like one is easier to achieve than the other.
That is probably
marriage
true.
Is like an extension of Big Boss. For anyone, it's going to be tough. No? The same person, same house, same people, same problems. Make food together, clean your clothes, blah, blah, blah. These small things destroy people. It's something else. People think it's affairs and money and all. I think balls. It's small things irritate the crap out of you. I would hate being with a male friend every day either. You know what I mean? You think a male buddy is great and all, but it'll irritate you.
No.
Farting, sneezing. Oh. Yesterday, I may have been guilty of...
Have you guys ever lived with roommates?
Me and Aisha?
Like roommate. No, roommates for real, right? Like, you know, not you and Aisha. You and Aisha, it's the same thing, right? I mean, like living with people, like all the time, you get on each other's nerves, right?
4 months in America with four guys and the bathroom to begin with was such a... You didn't want to go in. You held on.
God knows what's lying around,
right? I think we have come some way from there. At least like I have a flatmate, it has been a completely zero friction.
Flatmate or roommate?
Yes.
Separate rooms is different.
I stayed in a dorm once.
I will be safe.
with I stayed in a dorm once with 31 other people.
You were molested, remember, you told us that story.
But yeah, well, I mean, yeah, so living in a dormitory is really bad because everything is a turn system. So like everything, yeah, if someone is having a bath, tere baad mere ko de. If someone is pouring rice onto their plate, tere baad mere ko de. So there's always a number system, which is like never ending in a dormitory.
Yeah, there's a big difference. I'll tell you, Silvi, the big difference, the big difference is there's no sense of permanence. You know you're here for a little while and then you'll get out. Yeah. And you know you're going home. So there's a little difference there. Once you're in a permanent situation, there's, I keep looking back because I don't want to fight with anyone. what do you do? There's no other plan B. That's it. Plan B is this, what Akash and all do with this network sites and where they invent themselves and with different names and younger. I'm 22-year-old. Akash becomes Prakash. I like long walks on beaches. Suddenly likes long walks on beaches and all this crap. The five things you have to say to make a woman fall for you. It's there in the books.
Akash, I've done both flatmates and roommates, and flatmates are great. Right, when you're basically, if you have a little bit of space to retreat to.
Privacy, right? Privacy is the factor at the end of the day.
It becomes really, it's really fun to live with, like, people which you are not necessarily related to. You could have fun with, you know, party with, play video games with. All of that is fun, right? But the second, you have to smell somebody else.
You have the option of having your own cave also, which is important. Yeah.
But you know, when Dhaval stayed over Cyrus when we did the Couch Pundits episode, he stayed, and now I understand what you mean, Amit, because like when you don't have a room to go back to because your friend is staying over or whatever, even though you like the guy, he will get on your nerves.
Smelling somebody's farts means you cannot stay with them for a long time.
I think that's the point.
He's using it as a metaphor of sorts, but I totally agree. No one should stay with anyone. Literally, sometimes, but I mean, one of us is guilty.
I'm thinking of my roommates, not yours, mine.
Bro, 49 batting. Trust me, digestive system doesn't get better. Please let everybody know that. That's the truth.
Next story, please.
All right.
Cool. Next Cyrus, you are very agitated about something that you wanted to discuss.
I can't remember. I got that ADD.
7 years. I think you want to talk about the 7 years.
Huh? The 7 years. We didn't celebrate the 7 years. We just completed 7 years of prime ministership.
Yep.
Oh.
Awkward Modi silence.
Ji. Yes.
Nobody came to the birthday party. But
the
remember,
7 year itch.
Social distancing, huh? The 7 year itch has started. Yes.
Yes, for sure.
Because he made comments for the first time. He has spoken to the rank and file with these kind of words in a very chaste Hindi speech, which I couldn't understand, but translated finally, where he said that we have to get used to dealing with defeat. Okay. Where he's never taken that kind of line, which means little bit he's preparing them that they will never have that mandate which they had before. And they have to understand that it's to and fro of politics is now going to play a bigger role going forward.
Ravish Kumar took 4 days of reporting to do a fact check on Modi's speech. And he's still going. I think aaj bhi usi ke upar jana padega because there's so much stuff in that is inconsistent. So it's been Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all 3 days Ravish was talking about that only. And Wednesday he's like, aap soch rahe honge ki 3 din se main iske bare mein kyun baat kar raha hoon.
It's
I thought we were talking about the Pandus.
Let's take a quick break and then come back to that.
Okay.
We're 30 minutes in, so we should take our break.
Oh, what is the break? Is there a break? How is
there's a break for the sake of a break, right?
Positive
now.
With the reinforcement and thinking where we imagine that the sponsor is there and then we just say nice things. But can you show us your ping at the same time? Because that will bring us a sponsor
isn't
like
long
this.
Enough, or I would get the camera in with me.
Wall pe karna dikh raha. Just fire away at the wall, boss. You're an Indian. You see a wall pe.
I promise myself I would not live in a bachelor house. Ye mera aashiyana hai. I'm going to come back in a second.
You want someone to hold it? What's the issue? You tell me honestly. Just walked out.
Also,
as usual, a guest on our show. This is almost like a political show. That just walked out. For no reason. Just when we were discussing the Prime Minister, by the way, he walked out.
That is true.
Talking about the Prime Minister, I've heard there are some rumors flying around of a possible rift between Yogi and Modi.
That's always been there. There are two strong camps that way. But for what it's worth, nobody has challenged him. He's still the alpha. But there's definitely rumbling that, and that rumbling is what you're saying. So if there's ever, cracks, then that will be the divide. which would mean if he becomes more popular, then Yogi will, and they still have the mandate, and Yogi becomes the prime minister or the leader of the nation, in which case you come back on the show and say, please bring Narendra Modi right back. You know, it's called the theory of relativity. You learn, my friends. How are you, Captain? We're very short pee, huh?
Yeah, I pee often.
Only half what? Okay.
You stopped in the middle.
All right, let's get to the next one.
Let's go to the next one.
It's for Kegel muscles. It strengthens the anus area a lot if you do that. It allows you to deal with prostate and piles and all. It's very good if you do that. In fact, if you have no job, this is one of the things you should do all day, I believe. Just, you know, exercise for your good health going forward. Yeah.
We shall. Would
you guys take your advice?
I'm doing it right now.
That's it. Okay. Yeah, go ahead. Use the other orifice to speak to us. Chalo, let's go to the big story about the cops from Tardeo. Yes.
So, two Mumbai cops, they didn't report in for duty for 9 years, ever since they were shifted from the local arms department in Tardeo to the police station in Malabar Hill. So they got shifted from they were transferred from Tardeo to Malabar Hill. They stopped showing up to work. Their office did not realize only that they're not showing up for 9 years, and they kept pocketing 75% of their pay for these 9 years. I don't know whether to be impressed or sad.
Why did they lose the payment work?
Why did they lose 25%?
There
must be a payment scheme where you get paid through a bank account or something, directly transfer, and there must be something which comes in hand or something.
No, but it's a tax, I guess. Sorry, do you have an answer? Share an answer?
So what I remember reading was at first they were getting like 50% of the salary, and then after like 1 month or 2 months or something, they started getting 75% of it. But exact reason I will find out.
No, that's again. Do the senior management in the station know that this is happening or not? We had a similar story.
So they found out. No. At first they didn't. They found out. The deputy commissioner of police in their department, in their zone, found out, and there was a survey or something done. An inquiry was done where it said, "Okay, these guys have been misconduct. We are finding them." Having been indulged in misconduct was the term they used.
They never came to the station and did duty.
They kept
for 9 years.
No, they kept receiving letters and all also from the station. Okay, guys, you need to come to work. Come on, guys, what are you doing?
But they
for
never
9 years.
Fired.
And they were like, they never replied, nothing. Yeah. They got fired. But they were just, not before this.
No, now it's all come out, but I'm saying in the meantime, and they don't reply to the letters, there's no step by step process like there would be in a company.
What were they doing for the 9 years?
We are Indian. We don't have to have a job.
Antriksh, you raised so many questions in my mind, you know.
It's an interesting story. Yeah.
Like I want to know ki ye log 9 saal kiya kya fir. Were they like working in some office? Did they have a parallel life?
Remember, it's in our DNA. You just stare at people. You can just do that. If you're getting paid, I'll do that. You stand on the road and look at people with your eyes open, just like that. Just stare at people. We do that beautifully. You don't even need a camera or a crew to come and whatever. Yeah.
Do you guys remember the story of the BMC sweeper who essentially subcontracted?
Postal worker that Silvery brought up in another Cock and Bull some months back, guys. Okay. Similar story. Same thing. The money was being collected for many years before they saw the fraud. But that was pure fraud, beautifully done. Here, it looks like there must be someone helping them. Here's what
the article goes on to say. It says, subsequently, the two constables were suspended from the force in 2013. For the initial 3 months, 50% of their salaries were deposited in their accounts. As per the rules, after 3 months, they started drawing 75% of their monthly income. So they were suspended, but they were not fired. So they kept getting their salary still for
and
9 years.
Nobody bothered to check on them.
The suspension period never ended. I think the suspension period just never
this
ended.
Makes sense.
Can I then say that it's not really their fault?
Yeah.
No, they just enjoy the system.
They just enjoy it.
In fact, they did. I wouldn't even give them credit for having gotten the salary. They just got it out of
beautiful.
Yeah, Oloko, I take it back. They are not talented.
No. They're just lucky. Lottery lucky.
The bureaucracy is that bad.
They are the best policemen, though. They are just not doing their job. They're not taking any bribes because
now
the state is already giving them bribes.
Arms department in Tardeo, you come to Malabar Hill where there's no work, no crime. You attack people like me for walking dogs. That's your highlight. Doggy ko andar lena. That's probably the only time he came close to battle. You know, the Kshatriya warrior in his uniform. He comes out there, he stops the car and he tells my wife, "Oh, doggy ko andar lena, doggy ko andar lena." That was the moment of bahaduri, you know, which will get him the Veer Chakra posthumously or whatever. So I think I understand that the fact that Malabar Hill posting, if you talk to any of them, the nicer ones, is like the sentence of, it's like a crime, literally, for them, paradoxically. What do you say?
Although still,
they hate that post.
There's no there are no traffic lights. So there's no signal toding ka this. There's no crime as such. There is crime, but there's very minimal crime. In most cases, the people who you're talking to can reach like your boss's boss's boss with like a phone call or two. Yeah. And so I mean, like, you know, it's not the best space for the entrepreneurial policeman.
And there's no money that can be, you know, circulated in the economy, so to speak. You know, that also is a very big issue.
I'd like
there's no restaurants,
I'd like
no hotels.
Huh? I just want to know what they did for 9 years.
The comedian's doing really well right now.
So they've not said what they did for 9 years. But it does say that Sheikh goes on to say, like, to the Indian Express, the ones who releases the article, they interviewed one of the officers. His name is Sheikh something.
You just drew that in. You didn't give us a name till now. You suddenly said Sheikh said.
Okay, no, the names are given. The names are not important. But the names are Ramlal, Digambar, Manjule. And Samad Salim Sheikh.
Why did you give us these names? Can't remember
because
the names.
They're not important.
Let's
but
call
anyway,
them Tommy
in
and
this
Bunty.
Country, any name that suggests a community is important.
Oh, is important.
Now,
so
this...
very secular.
You just said the
we've
one name,
got one
so
Hindu
many
cop,
people...
we've got one Muslim cop. It's a very secular story. We need one Christian cop and it becomes Amar Akbar Anthony. It's all good.
So I'm saying the latter does say that he is still going to appeal the dismissal in the Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal. So he's still like,
but
no, I was wrongfully dismissed.
Oh, he was suspended. So he's saying that they suspended me and I remain suspended.
Yeah.
In that sense, he is right.
Yeah. If you don't lift the suspension, then he should not be coming to work until he's unsuspended, right? If you suspend somebody, they're not supposed to come.
I think, again, Akash, I think spotted it correctly the first time. It's very simple. Okay, this is the system. They started paying him. They suspended him. I'm sitting at home watching TV. All good. And you're getting paid. Come on. Who wouldn't do that?
I don't blame them. I don't blame them at all.
I know. It's strange how reading the story completely flipped all of us. Now, first we were just like, how can this happen? What kind of inefficiency is this? How corrupt are people?
No problem. I mean, the two cops are not the issue for me. The issue is the system. That they can have two cops, they suspend the two cops, they walk around for 9 years doing sweet F-all, and they remain on the on the rolls in some way or form. That's what is mind-boggling. 9 years.
And
this
the
police...
balance cops are busy protecting people who probably don't need it. The result is, salak gali mein raat ko police nahi hai. So Cyrus, you should be happy ki kutta nahi rokega koi.
Again, you come to the right locality, doggy. Speaking about doggies. Because if they're not chasing doggies, they're exactly powpodoing behind some VIP who nobody knows. And for which 40 people are standing in, you know, with their stomachs in for 2 seconds till he passes. I don't know why they do that. But notice they all do. Their stomach goes in and the salute is very robust. It's very robust. The body language changes. It's suddenly like they've been shot in the bum. Bang! It's always like that.
Rooster.
But otherwise, the body language, you see at 3 o'clock, you know, the guy is dead. He's 20 minutes away from dehydration, social ostracization, and, you know, complete metamorphosis and change that would make him into another human being. I feel very sad for them sometimes in the sun. I'll be honest. Sometimes I even thought, should I give a Coke or something to one or two of them?
It's a rough job.
It's
right?
Not like I... Now she's saying no. She thinks I only abuse... when I pass them. But it's not true. I have the milk of human kindness. I always thought maybe, you know, if not a Coke, a Diet Coke, because some of them are really unfit, you feel they shouldn't do that. Amit's house is right there near Teenbati. We can just go get the Diet Coke. There are 500 Diet Cokes in his house. Folks, listen to this. If you ever go to Amit's house, if you ever invite you, or if you ever shoot inside, it's only Diet Cokes. It's made up of Diet Cokes. You open the door, Diet Cokes. There's everywhere Diet Cokes. That's
the
only thing
Diet
that is.
Coke. I also have coffee.
If the caffeine and Diet Coke is not enough, have a little bit more.
I don't know, man, Amit. That doesn't make me want to come to your house more. You know what I mean?
Imagine more Diet Coke for me.
If you had Nimbu, then I would.
Well, actually, I have
one.
Nimbu Pani also. Cyrus has got Nimbu Pani. Both tastes come to
just the Nimbu. I'll get the rum, so then it'll be complete.
Okay. I don't have rum in my house.
I knew it.
Oh, yes.
He means R-O-M
and whiskey.
Please understand, Akash. R-O-M. He doesn't have rom in his house. No, don't ever
rom,
come there.
Rom? Yeah. Okay, no rom. Okay.
Too much of a pull. Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
How much bad comedy can the person take who's watching this? You have to stop here at some point.
What else we got, Antrish? Anything new?
Hey, listen, guys. Akash is there. I know, but we'll run out of time. So I want to quickly ask him. The tweets that happened, I want to ask you, Akash, tell me honestly. Do you think this PC thing is now going too much out of control?
It's bullshit. No, because there's institutionalized racism from ECB that they don't want to address. So invariably, this poor kid gets
context,
knocked
guys,
off.
Context. Okay. I have no idea what you're talking
about. I'll give context. No, I am very agitated about this and Dhawal won't let me talk about it on my fucking podcast.
No, you have to talk about it.
Is fucking bullshit. So this kid, okay. So ECB is under
Robinson.
Some fire, okay. You know, so
they don't know. They don't know anything. Like, just
yeah. So I'll tell them. English Cricket Board is under some fire for being racist in certain things. Okay, there is a whole story of allegations, and a lot of people have spoken about a lot of things. Okay, this kid who is 20 something years old right
25
now.
25 now. He was 16 then.
Prime of his cricketing career. You can imagine a 25 is your great year to play cricket. And this fucking ECB is like, you posted something when you were 16. So you are going to get suspended now.
I'll just tell you what he posted quickly. So that give them a little context. As a 16-year-old sitting in a subway, he texts his pal trying to be funny and cheeky or cocky and a little racist for sure. Hey, I'm sitting next to my new Muslim friend. He's a bomb. You know, haha, hashtag something or the other. And next one was, I'm sitting next to a guy who's definitely got Ebola. Haha. So he was obviously trying to be funny. It was in bad taste, no doubt. But A, he was 16. And B, they just suspended him indefinitely for now. He paid the first test and they said, okay, now buzz off.
And can you imagine what, how stupid this is and how overcorrective this is and how unnecessarily...
Wait. It goes more. It goes
and
more.
It gets worse. Yeah.
The IPL chats are there where there's Josh Butler and gang, Owen Morgan have exchanged. You know, they make fun of, they're there, these, I don't use the word Goras, these foreigners together. And they irritate with the sir culture, okay? That Indians have this submissive way of talking to them all the time. Hmm. He's sir, you batted very well, sir. So they use this sir as a lampoon amongst themselves where they go on using sir because they're making fun of the Indians. Now, it is racism to some extent, but you know, how fragile are we? Who gives a damn, you know, after some time? It's like four of us in England making fun of something about a Cockney guy or whatever. Is it really racism or just four guys just trying to be a little funny? I mean, there's a line, you know. I mean, it's really difficult after some time.
I think that...
And wait, the last one, Akash. Huh. The last one is really... Just hear this one. This is a complete rumor. Stuart Broad and Jimmy Anderson are best friends. Jimmy Anderson sees his new haircut and instas him back saying, ki, you look like a lesbian.
Yeah.
For which now he's getting flack. How dare you make homophobic... I mean, what? We can't say anything?
What?
It's like you and me are friends and I say, you know, you look like a lesbian from the haircut. Trying to be funny. Okay, this is between you and me, actually. I know it's a public forum, but it's between you and me. And how is lesbian reference wrong? You know, it's like a black person is black, a white person is white, a Chinese person is Chinese. I mean, the reference is not, what is wrong with it? They're known to sometimes have short hair. Is it wrong? So, homophobic. So what I'm saying is just going, Akash, you talk now.
I have a lot of feelings pent up about this. So, but the problem here is ki, this is not how you correct for what's happening. This is a knee-jerk reaction, as fucking usual. Ki, hey, 10 log ko suspend kar do, awaaz karo, make headlines to make it look like you're solving shit when you're not really solving anything. These players were people, and what you are leaving no room for change. A 16-year-old put something up. He's 25 now. You think he's an idiot?
He was an ass.
Give him some benefit of doubt that in the last 8 years, he's learned a thing or two about the world, considering he was 16. Like, come on. Okay, yeah. Owen Morgan and this thing, the sir wala tweet that they were doing. We do it as Indians all the time. We make fun of each other like that. It's a small town versus city person fucking joke as well. Okay, so to say that it's racist is taking
it's more a cultural joke than a racist joke. I'd like to separate the two. It's not really about race. It's a cultural thing about, and in India, in sports, we always respect senior figures and all that. So it's always there. You know, it's how Silvery behaves, for example. Especially with the North Indians, it's there. They'll always have this respect for you. They'll never be disrespectful to the senior. So, yeah. I mean, it's no biggie, you know, it's just part of the culture. So, I don't know why people react so badly.
Cyrus, how many times have you seen some new person in the industry walk up to you and be like, sir, please, sir, you are a great actor, sir. This is how we talk. So, when
I'm okay with sir, only when they call me Sajid, I react. Until then, I'm okay. The sir is fine.
So, if you start confusing cultural references with racially charged references...
Exactly.
You know, you can't just... This is like saying, a straight person shouldn't say the word gay anymore.
I think we should all shoot ourselves. Have we not made religious jokes, communal jokes, racist jokes, jokes about dwarfs, midgets, paralyzed people, cancer victims, coma? I mean, what have we not done? The intent is everything. I keep saying that. Why? Oh, forget it. This PC is it's gone too far. We have to fight this PC right now. This is madness. This poor kid's career is gone because everyone's going to say, oh, he's a communalist and he's a racist and he's a this and he's that. And even if he is or was, I mean, the punishment should fit the crime.
So that's just it, right? I think where I would come out on this, right, is that while I get that it was a long time ago and, you know, forgiveness and growth and all of that, actions have consequences, right? And in this case, the context is, it should be a social consequence rather than a legal consequence here. In the sense that people should be maybe annoyed or maybe take him to task or something like that, but it shouldn't be like a banning.
That you're saying community service in that area. See, but
the
but
nuanced,
this is...
the amount of nuance one requires to get through a woke person conversation on the internet is
I can't do woke shit, man.
This guy has trained his entire fucking life to be the best fast bowler in the on the planet. That's what he's worked on. He's not an orator.
Yeah.
He doesn't understand this shit, and you being this reactive towards it, any third party being reactive towards it and being aggressive towards these people, like they're the scum of the earth, you know, you're just...
Yeah,
like,
and again, I think, again, the great Akash today is nailing everything, has made a point that they have institutional racism. If you go back in years, I mean, before the Gavaskar era and before and everything, it's been there. And now suddenly you want to turn around and catch one guy and like let him take the butt for everything. That's not, you know, what you've got. You know, society is different and you deal with that. This specific case is a little different, you know, and deal with that.
This is something that you know, I mean, like the same stuff has happened in the US quite a bit, right? Particularly to baseball players. If I'm not mistaken, the same kind of thing where you're taking out tweets from like 6, 7, 8 years ago where they're 13, 14, 15 years old and saying something bullshitty, right? And I mean, like, they shouldn't be...
I'll give you a clearer example. Kevin Hart, the Oscars.
Right.
The homophobic joke, which if you actually listen to it, is not about his son and all. I've seen the whole bit and it's not homophobic. It's just funny. You know, but for which he had to step down from the Oscars. So, but it was done 7, 8 years before that Oscar moment.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking that they have to have some aggressive action.
A statute of limitations. At least have a statute of limitations for this kind of
thing. And especially for a kid, he's 16 is 16, bro.
So the thing is, statute of limitations gets complicated, right? Because now you're talking about fixed periods of times. Now, there is variance in the degree of offense, right? What you're describing over here is not very offensive. But what happens if something comes out for somebody who says something super offensive, right? So there is variation over there. So statute of limitations, I think, is a little difficult to get to. But I hear what you're saying, right? That it needs to be...
No, but it loses its sheen over the years, you know. Yeah. Crime doesn't remain a crime unless it's like
doesn't.
Murder or rape or whatever.
It doesn't.
It does lose its sheen a little bit, you know, after some time.
Okay, take, for example, the Me Too stuff, right? What Harvey Weinstein did was very, 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 very different from what Louis C.K. did.
Okay.
It was very, 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 very different from what Aziz
Louis C.K. did nothing.
No, excellent. Doing something and commenting on an Instagram post cannot be held in the same light. I'm sorry, I don't see a world where both of these things have the same kind of impact.
I'm not talking about that.
Yeah, I'm not talking about it as a comparison. I'm just saying that there is a, even when you're talking about commentary or you're talking about saying something, an utterance, an expletive, what have you, right? There is a range in terms of how much that expletive or how much that comment will be. It is not so bad to make fun of sir. It would be much worse for a British person to use a word like
coolie, something like,
exactly.
When I went to England, they used to call me Paki when
Paki.
I was walking down the street. See,
exactly.
That felt
that's
racist.
Different.
That felt like somebody was saying something bad
exactly.
to me.
Exactly. That's different, right? So that's what I'm saying. So there is a range in expression as well. So to put a statute of limitations, I feel, is not the appropriate response. The appropriate response over here is not legal. The appropriate response over here is not, it's a social response. And by social response, I mean the reaction of the people around him, the reaction of the people of his fans, how much fandom, if he has fans of a certain type, those fans will decrease. It should not be that he gets banned from cricket.
I think the point we're trying to make is slightly different, which is that the PC points have reached a point where it's gone crazy. It's just going crazy. You know, it's not fitting. The proportion is not fitting all the time. And that's really, I mean, no one's taking this guy's side. He must have been a complete idiot. Mm. But look at it in context. He's sitting in a tube. It's like a young celebrity. He's got a pal. Let's call him Ajay. And he's sending a message to Ajay and he's trying to be funny and cheeky at the same time. Yeah, so you make fun of the guy. You make fun. It could be racist. Could be whatever. But put it in context. It's not really... He's not out there to destroy a whole race or something. He's just trying to be a funny guy and he got it wrong. And it's not in good taste. If you were to hear it. But between him and Ajay... Hey, Amit, that day I won't mention the community. You and I sat and said these guys are lazy and this is, we had a conversation. That doesn't mean we're racist, you know. It doesn't mean those people from the community are not our friend. friends?
No, no.
I mean, my closest friends are those, as you very well know.
Yeah, absolutely. But we were talking, but I mean, like, again, in this contest, what I would say is that even when you're talking about PC, right, there's a pendulum on PC as well, right, in terms of how it swings, right? Right now, PC is at its like absolute zenith. And yeah. Compared to anything I've ever seen before, right, in my life, there was a similar time in the early 90s where everything was so PC about every single thing, right? That, I mean, like, it was not as magnified as it is today because of the internet, but it did. When I was in college in the US in early 90s, I really felt this PC thing was like, you know, hey, man, are we sure that we really don't want to be able to do this kind of thing?
As somebody who was young in the 90s and who is back here right now, I say the word politically correct is the wrong way to go about it. Mm-hmm. It's only about what you can get away with. That's what it boils down to. I'll give you an example. We have people in this country who are members of the legislature who have said things that should on paper
get
on
them
the face
wherever,
of
yeah.
you in jail.
Yeah, law books.
Okay, but it doesn't. Yeah.
Inciting riots, inciting passions, causing violent acts, everything, it's there in the law books. You don't need to even, it's there.
So, and even the social outrage is not there because a lot of the people absorbing that information agree with what that person is saying and share in that hateful opinion. So what is politically correct becomes very scary because there is no objective decision making involved anymore. Everything
Agreed.
Is feelings. And there are no facts anymore. Tera fact hai, toh mera bhi fact hai. Aray, aisa nahi hota hai. Do truth nahi ho sakta hai.
Which also comes back to this Ollie Robinson back in England because he's a bakra at the end of the day. He's easy.
Yeah.
You just take him down and it looks very good. Like how fast action was taken. We will not tolerate racism. But you know, it's just... For us, he's actually become a victim, in my eyes.
No, I think you're right. I think that you see this like in many, many different contexts, right? Where the way that people react to speech, which they are uncomfortable with today, right, has gotten so... And all that's required is discomfort.
Be careful.
That to me...
We will not be able to say he or she. Soon all that will be taken away from us. Huh? You'll have to use all kinds of pronouns to say hello to people and all this. There's no end to this.
But see, that I don't have so much of an issue. That's more of a self-actualization, self-realization issue.
Yeah, that's if they want to be called
self-actualization is far away.
Right. No, but I mean, like in the sense that, you know, if somebody wants to be referred to as they and that makes them more comfortable, it's no skin off my nose. You know, I don't see why I should have any kind of issue with that.
You're a greater man than me.
I don't care.
As a right-wing supporter of right-wing America, I find it very hard. I just want to say, I will not invest in the Ollie Anderson story because my mother and him have the same name. Yes, my mother is a fast bowler from England called Ollie. That's right.
Yeah. No, but what I'd say is that basically the way I would, the speech itself, right, the way that people are reacting to speech today has become so... dramatic and over. Did you guys hear about the Apple stuff that happened over the last couple of weeks? So there are two things that happened, right? So first, Apple hired a guy to lead their advertising business. That guy had written a book. Okay, it was written like, you know, have you ever read Hunter Thompson?
Yeah. That happened some time back.
Like a month ago or so.
Yeah. Huh.
Yeah, so it was basically about this, right?
They exposed the inner dealings and all,
You know, so it was like a Hunter Thompson book, so Stream of Consciousness, kind of written like that, right? And as part of that, he made a comment in the book where he was comparing women of Silicon Valley compared to this woman who he's falling in love with, who was like this massive Amazon and like, you know, was like, you know... physically imposing and could like, you know, actually could do a bunch of stuff. And compared to that, he called Silicon Valley women soft. Right. And basically, you know,
that's exactly it. He called Silicon women soft. That was the good thing. Yeah.
And that turned into this whole thing. The guy lost his job. All of that happened and turned into a whole different thing. Right. And the thing is that the way that a company reacts shows a lot. Right. I mean, like the fact that Apple fired this guy is kind of insane because this was a best selling book. There is no way they did not know that he wrote this book before they hired him. They hired him because he was a prominent technologist in the ads in the ad tech space. He had worked at Facebook where he had led the advertising thing. He had quit Facebook because he had some issues with privacy and stuff like that. He went on to do his own thing. He wrote this book. Apple recruited him to come on board.
In his experience, if he felt the Silicon Valley women were not as intimidating and powerful or alpha-like as this particular woman, how is that? That is an observation. If tomorrow you think Indians are less aggressive than Pakistanis, it's not a racist comment. If that's what you feel after observing us, I don't find that as racist. That's your observation. What's the racism in it?
And I think that, you know, the the way that the that people react to this, right, is instructive in its own way. So Apple also is a famously hard work culture, like famously hard work culture. And this week, or last week, I think they announced that starting September or October, they want their staff to come into work 3 times a week. Okay, massive petition against, by Apple.
As against once a week.
As against work from home. Right now, it's all work from home, right?
Okay, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're like, work from home is right now. We are in the US. We are in California. We're all getting fucking vaccinated. There are vaccines in the streets flowing, literally. So yeah. Anybody who wants to get vaccinated can get vaccinated over there.
Now,
right?
Watch what you say. 7 years of prime ministership and you're making a little criticism there, which I didn't like.
I'm just talking about the vaccines in the streets.
No. You
US.
Said that they were available everywhere and that's like a slap on the half face because it may not be available everywhere here. No.
The streets of Cupertino are paved with Covaxin. But essentially, vaccines are available over there.
Everybody say bye to Amit Doshi. He's been lovely. Lovely talking to him.
they wanted people to come into work. And there was a petition that, hey, you cannot ask us to come to work. It is, and I mean, like the kind of language used, right? It's like basically saying that asking us to come to work means you don't respect us. We feel that we are being pushed and oppressed. And I'm like, dude, go to fucking work. I'm sorry, but you work for a company. The company has always been a no work from home company. They've always been very, very kind of firm.
Yeah, but this is a whole different ballgame because of this fear factor and anxiety factor. Would you be able to push your employees? I don't know.
No, so I, even with the vaccine out.
I mean, when will you draw the hard line? Tell me, when can you draw the hard line and say, boss, abhi aana padega, nahi to two small objects from your pants will be in my hand.
I would say not that far away. Right. I mean, like, once there is a degree of safety, once we feel safe in that sense, I would say, yeah, pretty much immediately I want people to come to work.
If someone at that point says they're still not feeling comfortable, they've got old parents at home, etc. We all have our reasons.
We'll have to see, right? I mean, like, each situation is different. But I mean, like, if the situation doesn't demand it completely, I want you at
work. You're saying the Apple employees acting entitled and saying, look, the situation is such that I don't want to come. And it
strikes me as ridiculous that you don't want to go to the office for, I don't know. I mean, like, but the point is that this is all part of the same kind of this, right? This is all the same, like, it's all part of the same mishmash, right? Where you,
our rights.
Yeah, correct. We know our rights and we are going to this, right? I mean, like, I was listening to, I'm going to flip this to the NBA because I always do, but I was listening to a really interesting podcast.
This is the point where Akash should have gone to pee.
They were talking about the difference between labor and management in NBA, right? And how right now what's happened in the NBA is that labor has, by labor, I mean the players, have taken all the power. James Harden demands a trade for whatever reason goes to Houston, and it's affecting the on-court product. Because what is now happening is that you essentially have three teams that can win the championship. And that's it. Nobody else can get close to it. Right? Because players are being able to... You're killing competition, right? These sports leagues are set up in a way where the idea is that there needs to be equality of competition. So all 30 teams have a chance to compete.
But that makes no sense because if you don't have competition, the viewer is going to get disenchanted.
It's
going to
drop off. So the NBA ratings this year were down by 40% because the players don't give a fuck about the regular season. The owners don't give a fuck about the regular season. Nobody does. So during the season, the ratings were down tremendously. And so the results to a lot of these games are predetermined. The teams are tanking.
It's not because basketball is a boring game. That couldn't be the reason.
No, because basketball is the most fun game to watch. I mean, like, dude, I'm not waking up at 6 in the morning to watch
it. In your face!
I think it's like this, the lady who was playing tennis and she wanted to not give interviews. And then I made her give... And I think it's like that, right? Like, especially when it comes to sports persons, I think these people do something that very few of us can achieve. Okay. They are superhuman and it takes a lot of time to work on that. And if they need a little bit of leeway here and there, they should get it. If they have to be punished, then it has to be in a way that at least makes sense.
I don't know, Akash. I thought she should have done the interviews as well. Okay, I'm saying she could have just come and said, look, I don't want to play the tournament because I'm not in a good frame of mind. And everybody would love her. Okay, she's earning enough money. She's loved by... you sign up and you follow the rules.
Why does tennis get the kind of money? Why do tennis players get the kind of money, kind of acclaim, kind of prize money that they get? Why do they get the endorsements they get? It's not in a vacuum.
The people, the fans.
It's because
the whole system, correct?
Yeah, it's a system that's being created, right? And the fact is that, and see, this is the thing that really bothers me about some of the NBA stuff as well, right? These players who are there, right, are extremely high paid, and they should be high paid. They should be. They are the reason why we watch this stuff in some way fundamentally. But at the same time, when they fuck around like this, they screw everybody down the line.
Yeah.
How many people are dependent on the... So, the, if you look at the number of people employed by the NBA, there are 400 players, 450 players, right? There are tens of thousands of people employed by different teams and stuff like that. Now, so when you're affecting the competitive balance, when you're affecting the interest in a sport, whether it's NBA or tennis or whatever it is, you're screwing all of these people who are making more than a living wage probably, but not much more.
She's the highest earning player in the world, female athlete in the world. Because of her half Japanese heritage and all, every brand is with her. She's loved by women of all cultures because she's mixed race, blah, blah, blue. And she's greatly talented and deserves all that. It's a nice girl. I follow her career. But I can't understand this attitude problem. Now, you know, you've got this whole depression thing that you do. And also, I understand you have an empathy level for her. But hello, you can't come and tell them, okay, I don't want to give the interview. Everybody else is giving the interview. It's not right, bro. It's just not right. It's completely unfair.
Is the interview... let me put it this way. Is interview integral to fair competition?
It is. And her exact words in the beginning was, they keep asking me why I fail on clay. So she can't take criticism because she doesn't have a great record on clay. But hello, this is very important because, you know, that's not right. It's not like it's my pop's playground now and I will play this way. It's a playground whether you're number one or 100, the same for everyone.
If why we watch it is because it's competitive because of her, I don't think anybody watches tennis for her interview.
Are very short and then you do that drop shot. And, you know, especially when the men play.
Akash, do you do PR?
Huh?
Do you do PR?
Barely.
When you're doing a show, do you put
just
tickets
enough.
On?
Yeah. Yeah,
you do this stuff, right? You do this stuff.
Yeah,
why do you do this stuff? Why do you market? Why do you talk to... When a newspaper reporter wants to talk to you on something, why do you talk to them? You do this so that you can increase the overall value of the enterprise.
Bro, why do we listen to a man?
What are we really afraid of?
It's all part of the game. Why should she be given an exemption when there's a system? Next, what, she'll get three serves and the others two? I mean, it can go there, you know, because this is part of a system. If you're a tennis lover, you follow their comments. Everybody wants to know what happened at the news conference. And take a few hard questions. What's the big deal? You're making $5 million every month or more.
Yeah.
And you don't even have to answer the questions too hard, right? I hear what you're saying. I respect mental health issues. I think that people's mental health issues should be accommodated. But the way to accommodate them is, can I take time off from this tournament? It's not that I want to play the tournament, but I won't talk to the press. That's not
fair.
Cool.
Fair.
And because of this, I am not going to marry Naomi Osaka. I put it down, top 10, in case my marriage breaks. I put her down as top 10, but she's out now. She's 11. But she can, Naomi, you can come back. I'll learn how to say your name properly. And secondly, as long as you do the press conferences in the Wimbledon and following tournaments, all good. And the Chennai Open resume.
You know what I really feel
which
like
is now the Pune Open.
What invariably ends up happening is now we get so distracted by the conversation at hand. And I'll give you a sort of offhanded analogy of an example. It's like with colleges, the conversation around colleges when I was growing up was always about reservation. And the reservation conversation obviously keeps coming back again and again as well. However, at some point it struck me ki shayad agar enough colleges hote to reservation ka problem hi nahi hota. You know what I mean?
That's too idealistic.
I also don't think that's true.
Every single child in India will get a chance.
Even if every single child in India were to get a chance, there are educational institutions which give you a step up compared to other educational institutions.
Okay. I agree with you. But when you... abhi kya ho raha hai ki there's barely enough colleges to just fucking have kids. Enough decent colleges. So if there were more decent colleges, then automatically there would be less aggression in this. Then there would be... clear scarcity. So what I'm trying to say is with ECB
demand
also,
supply.
There are racial issues and wo logo nahi acknowledge karne gaye. शायद स्पोर्ट्स में ऐसे मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज है जो किसी को एक्नॉलेज नहीं करने गए
ट्रू शी इज टॉप ऑफ द हीप ब्रो शी कुड हैव जस्ट स्किप द टूर्नामेंट शी
आई एम कन्विंस्ड बाय आर्गुमेंट नो
नीड फॉर गेटिंग
टू ऑल दिस नो आई एम कन्विंस्ड बाय आर्गुमेंट आई रिसेंट व्हाट आई सेड अर्लियर एंड आई हैव चेंज्ड माय ओपिनियन बिकॉज़ आई एग्री विद यू इट्स अ होल पैकेज टेक इट और लीव इट इफ यू आर
हैविंग सेड इट
इन
it is a little scary that Naomi has issues, because you think she has the world at her feet, and when someone like that seems to have issues, but she literally has the world at her feet, literally. I mean, she's probably one of the most popular sportswomen in the world by far, and probably in female category number one, which means men are still more. No, I'm joking.
It's time we should.
Oh shit! We're over an hour. Let's do an A. Let's do a couple of
dinner time.
Let's do a couple of quick MAs. Yes.
Yes. No answers.
Sure. Wow, we really kind of lost track of time this time.
Because Akash talks so much. Never call Akash. Yeah, Akash, thanks for the mangoes, man.
Hey, I'm glad you like that.
We are free. You're over. I in the last three. Last three just now.
Oh, chum, God chum, damn.
How can you? Mangoes are like alcohol. How do you stop here? I can't stop.
And they're too good. You want more? You let me know. I'll send you a dabba.
Send me the tree.
I'll send you.
Right, EMAs, right. And go.
Yes. The first one comes in from a couple of comments from Vinay RK. Very interesting. He says, hello from the Netherlands. So happy about these live streams later in the day. He also says, you might be happy to know that a few days ago, I accidentally looked at a fellow train passenger's phone screen, and he was playing Cyrus Says. You guys
in the Netherlands?
Come on, no way.
Yeah, in the Netherlands.
Sweet.
No way. Oh,
nice. In the Netherlands.
I thought you were setting us up for a Ollie Robinson joke. I was on the phone on the subway and I made some Indian bashing comment. You think that's true or he's just being nice?
No, I think, why would he? I listen, I'm nobody sure he's a nice guy.
Nobody on a train in India is listening to our podcast. How is someone in Netherlands getting that? Amazing.
No, but that's awesome. That's great.
I was in Amsterdam in 2019 when the world was a better place, and we drove that Elon Musk's, what's it called?
Tesla.
And you know when they put the thing on and it, you know, self drives. Baba, it's unbelievable, man. True traffic. It's, I felt like a little kid again, man. It's just amazing. Yeah, me and Kunal looking at each other, bachi gayo, kind of thing. Yeah, we Indians are. We get really animated with these things. Yeah. Anyway, sorry. All next.
Right. Yeah, next one comes in from Narsimhan Khadri. Says, people, if you were as rich and powerful as Mr. Gates, would you still be faithful to a single partner?
There's a correlation there. Actually, even the Osaka and money thing, I should take. I mean, there's a stupid correlation. This kind of thing has got. What do you say? I mean, how do you answer that? It's not about the money ever, whether he has money or not.
I agree. I think it's a personal kind of. I don't even want to say primal or whatever that
our
is.
Our game.
Right?
I mean, yeah. You know, but actually, you need
we just came at it from two different, complete angles, didn't we?
No, but they can meet. There's a confluence of thought where East meets West.
Yes. I think we're about the same. I think money doesn't matter in this case.
Yeah. I feel like it's your biological tendencies are to be sexually promiscuous. So monogamy is very important.
Against the natural order of play. Fair enough.
Yeah, monogamy is always going to be a choice because your biology is going to make you want to go other ways. So if you're choosing that life of monogamy, then don't fuck it up by...
I would like to not answer this question further because my wife is exactly 6 feet away and my daughter 5 feet away. So I would like to say that I agree. Bas.
So I'll just... the Chris Rock joke, I think, about this kind of maybe...
Dilemma? Relationship dilemma?
Basically, men are as faithful as their options. That's his joke.
Yeah.
And delivered in true style. Yes. And true British deadpan style. Yeah.
Amit's dating app stories come to prove this.
Very few options.
What is that new Tinder app you said?
What new Tinder app? The Silvery.
Bumble. Bumble. Or Hinge.
More modern version. Oh, you
Clubhouse.
Know all of them.
What?
Stop it. Calm
shoot
down,
your
calm
shot.
Down.
Oh, you're talking about shoot your shot.
Shoot your shot. Yeah.
That's a Clubhouse thing. That's not an app. Sorry.
Okay, inside
that's
Clubhouse.
Yeah,
that's an audio presentation.
Yeah,
it?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Is this
you
shoot
can, like,
your man. Shot?
Shot.
Is
shot.
Shoot
your shot. Yes.
Shot. S-H-O-T. Shot.
How many women and men sound so beautiful on the phone and then, oh my God.
So that's
why radio is there,
isn't
it?
Right?
Sorry, could you say that again, Amit?
Shoot your shot is the line from Hamilton, right?
The
musical?
No.
Yeah, the musical.
Isn't it a basketball term?
Not throwing away my shot is Hamilton.
Not throwing away my shot. Not shooting
not
my
throwing
shot.
Away my shot.
There you go. Akash,
yes. Well done.
correct that reference, you can
quote
context,
a musical like this.
And yes, just
only that,
shows that right now it proves that he's really heterosexuality is not going to be an issue anymore. Yes.
No,
yes.
But you know, after watching Hamilton, I found two more musicals to watch and they were awful. Uh-huh. Like legendary musicals, right? Like, yeah. Rent is supposed to be a legendary rock musical. It was terrible. I couldn't
only
watch it at all. It was horrendous.
Book of Mormon.
I've got that as well. I haven't seen that yet. Rent really, really turned me off the idea.
This is the point where you and me should pull out. Let the two boys enjoy their musicals. Get in their ballet shoes. Dim the lighting and little touchy-touchy.
Listen, Cyrus, if you cannot enjoy Hamilton, I think...
No, Hamilton is different. Hamilton is from a political point of view. It's satirical sort of
exactly.
Almost.
So it was
it's
great.
It's the best history lesson.
Yeah.
It's the most history I've learned in 2 hours in a very long time.
Yeah.
You know?
It was fantastic.
What about the speeches? Didn't you learn from the speeches?
Of Hamilton?
Leave it. Chalo. Leave it. Are we done?
Okay. No, sorry. A couple of questions. Still, there are a lot. We won't be getting to most of them. Just a couple more we can take. First is Nick says, Farooq Engineer's comments on this show is making headlines. And I searched, we are...
No,
I
saw that.
I sent it to him.
Yeah. You sent it to me, yeah.
What happened is now he's become the spokesperson for racism because he's caught in between having lived in Lancashire, being of Indian thing and all that. So he can give the first-hand accounts of what Akash spoke about, institutional racism, you know, where it was really hard for a lot of our guys from the 60s and 70s. I mean, they were really, you know, targeted.
That's why I have I hear these stories from my uncles and stuff like that, right? When they moved to the US, the kind of shit that they had to deal with. And so that's why these days, I mean, like, you know, a lot of racism complaints really kind of fall on, like, I'm just like, what are you talking about? You know, I mean, like, I know people who, like, you know, they're walking in the street and somebody, like, pushed them into a wall and, like, you know, is calling them all kinds of names and shit like that. And you're talking about, like,
two very large white guys are, and they're huge, man. They're like, you haven't seen somebody that tall.
That's racism,
you know.
Calling them huge white guys.
No, and then when they push you, like, you know, they don't have to physically, like, push you for that. Like, when their shoulder juts into your shoulder, can't fadke haath mein aa gaya yaar.
Aur like a very bad mil-
sand nigs karke aisa bolke gaya wo mere ko.
Oh, wow, okay. Really?
Haan, and I was so amazed because everyone
when
was
this?
Asking. This is 2015, New York City, huh? New York City. So, matlab aisa, because all the more it's removed from your mind ki aisa kuch ho sakta hai tumhare
saath. But did they, aisa, this is after they saw your show.
I had almost the exact same thing happen to me when I was in college, but in my city. But the thing is that we were very close by to the city where the head of the Northeastern Ku Klux Klan headquarters were. And so that's why it wasn't so weird. But in New York, for this to happen in 2000, this was 96.
But would it be
and
less
I was
terrifying?
Amazed.
Would it be less terrifying? Tu to 6 foot ka aadmi hai. Main to 6 foot ka bhi nahi hai. It is like it's genuinely horrifying. Like, you know, I'm just saying that you can feel the hate. You feel you are hated, and it's not a nice feeling to be a upper caste Hindu male from India.
Yeah.
You've never felt it before in your life. You've never felt out of control.
I didn't know how to deal with it, honestly. I mean, like, the guy did that. He called me the sand, as you were saying, right? He pushed me against the wall. He shoved me as he was. I was at the, I was exiting the bar. He was entering the bar, right? And he just shoved me and went like that. And I was just like, wait, what? And then I was with a couple of friends. And one of them started wailing on this guy. White dude who was my friend, he just started whacking this guy. He's like, what the fuck did you just say? And it was, so I mean, like, you know, I didn't, but I was like, I didn't know how to react. It was like, just, you never experienced this. Just no idea.
This guy who pushed you, was his first name Donald?
It could very well have been.
Did he have tiny hands?
Orange
hand. Did he use the word huge at any point?
That's a good question.
Huge.
That's a good question.
Go
all right, folks. Okay. Silvi, can I go? I've got a old family, and they're all sorry, mom. I'm coming.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Okay, no,
take two. Sorry, mom. I'm coming.
Okay.
Cool.
All right.
Okay. Cool.
So are we done?
Done.
Okay. Yeah, I think we're good.
She's really hitting. Put your hand in the frame so they can see the hit. hitting him, making sure they can't be seen. Now, this is also victimization. No one takes this up. One day, the minority of hubbies who are traumatized in Malba Hill, the group of six of us.
Actually, let's stay on for a couple of minutes. We're at 298. Let's see if we can cross 300, no?
Yeah. We did just it. We just over here or 298
because we said we're ending. Yeah, people came on. We have to keep saying we're ending the show. Coming on immediately.
I think we lost a bunch of people because we said we're ending the show.
Yeah.
So I think we might.
Who's an awful host? Awful host with no sense. Unbelievable.
That's okay.
I know.
We'll do that. We'll hit the landmark next time.
We will.
Yes.
Cool. Yeah. Okay, guys. Cool. See you.
Thank you so much.
God bless
Thank
India.
Thank you for having me, guys.
Oh,
thank
you. Thanks, don't do that. We call you every time.
Follow me. Are, I was just going to ask Antriksh ki who backed out. Because he just messaged me last night.
Akash is scared to ask you. You're a big guy. Don't worry.
Usually books me like 1 month in advance. He's telling me great 3 months and all. But this time he was like the night before. I said, oh.
Jaldi bol kuch kahani hai. Jaldi bol.
Nothing. No story. Just needed someone nice. Needed someone nice. And I knew Akash would love to be on. So I asked him. And he said yes.
Always a pleasure, guys.
Why not? Thank you so much.
Because you're older than Silvery, he'll only say nice things. There's no point.
He's older than I am.
Actually, I'm older than Akash, even though I guess he looks older now, I guess. No, I don't know.
Akash, you're younger than Silvery. You look like his pop, yaar.
What are you saying? I'm 28 now.
And Silvery, you're?
I'm 29 in 2 days. 3 days.
2 days! Happy birthday. Oh, yeah. Good night, guys.
Okay, bye, guys.
Thank you.